What is Python? It is a high-level dynamically typed programming language. Now, what is high-level programming language? High-level means that the language there is no need of machine dependency. Like the language can be done on any machine, whether it has different hardware characteristics or not. So, if two systems are having different hardware characteristics, still we can run Python on those two machines. Dynamically typed means that in Python we don't need to declare the data type of the value. Like in Java, if we declare a type of value, like 6 is an integer, so we need to write int a equals to 6. So here in Python we don't need to declare the data type. Second, Python supports multi-paradigm programming language. What does multi-paradigm means? Multi-paradigm means that Python supports many types of programming models. Now, object-oriented is one model. Object-oriented means that a software or an software will be treated as an object. Like, what is an object? An object is a physical entity which has some attributes, physical attributes. So everything will be treated an object. So this object-oriented model will be studied afterwards. It is an advanced topic. Then imperative style means the same style which we do where we do simple logics and where we write code step by step codes. Functional means we will be creating many functions to do our create applications. Like we can make an application where we have coded all functions. We are calling those functions. So this functional style also where we can do our work using functions. Then the procedural style means that it is step by step, procedural oriented as well. So here Python supports many types of programming models, objective oriented, imperative, functional, and procedural. Then Python is an interpreted language. Interpreted in the sense that if the compilation and interpretation is done on the same steps. If we see C, C++, Java languages, there what happens? Compiling is done separately. What is a compiler done? What is a compiling? Compiling means converting our source code into machine code. So who does that? The compiler does that. So compiler is a tool which converts source code into machine code. Now why it is necessary to convert source code into machine code? It is because the system cannot understand the source code. It can only understand the machine code. So that's why compilation has to be done in order to the system to understand that machine language. Then interpretation means giving the output, executing whatever has been compiled has to be now executed to get the output. So in C, C++, Java, what is done there that compilation and interpretation are both done individually. But here in Python, it is an interpreted language means as you type, the code will be compiled and immediately you will get the interpreted output. That interpreted means line by line. As you type, you get the output. So that is why it is called interpreted language. Then Python supports dynamic data types. As I told, dynamic data types means the data type is decided at the runtime. So if you are writing here, this is Python shell. So here, whatever we write, we get the output of it. So suppose if I write a equals to 6. So here in Python, we don't need to declare the type of the value. So this is dynamically typed. As I type, it will recognize the type of the value. So 6 is integer value. So I didn't specify whether it is int or any other type of value. If I write a here, it will give me the output 6. So this is how things happen in Python. We don't need to declare the data type. So that is why it is dynamically typed language. And these are dynamic types. Then Python has simple and easy grammar. As we know that there is no syntax problems like semicolon or braces. So it is very easily written. It is easy to understand also. Then automatic memory management. So this will be studied when we do object-oriented programming. Automatic memory management means when we need some object that the memory will be automatically allocated for it in the system. As we complete the code, as the code is destroyed, the object also gets destroyed. So this is an automatic memory management. So automatically allocating the memory and then deallocating it. Then Python is free and open source. So Python is available freely. We can have all the packages freely. You don't need to buy anything to use Python. Then it is open source. Open source means we can easily change the Python code from the internet. Then Python was developed in 1989 by Guido van Rossum. So those were the features of Python. Now we come to Python applications. Now where is Python applicable? As we all know, web development is very important for any language. We need to develop our web applications. So we need something to develop our applications. Now in Python, how we do web application? We have many frameworks. So one is Django framework, Flask framework. So in Python, without frameworks, we cannot do web development. Then second application of Python is in data science, as these days data science is very, very popular. And that data science is including machine learning, data visualization. So Python has application in that. Then we have Python application. We can create games also using Python. So all these can be done. We can use GUI interface. So what is GUI means? GUI is your interface where you connect with your applications. Without interface, you cannot open any application. So you use an interface. So in Python, if you want to create a GUI application, we use Tkinter mostly. Also, we can use PyQt. These are all GUI tools to create simple desktop applications. Then Python versions. Now we have Python versions. First is Python 1.0. It was the oldest version. Now the latest one is 3.0 version. Now Python IDE. IDE means development environment, where we develop our codes, where we write our codes, Python codes. So what are the IDEs? So these are the four IDEs which are commonly used: PyCharm, Spider, Python IDLE. So this one is the IDLE, which is the common one. We get this IDLE when we download Python. We get this automatically. So here we can do the codes. So this is the default one where we will do our Python coding. Then Visual Studio Code is also very popular for doing Python programming. Now we will come to some basic operations in Python. Now suppose in Python, if I want to add two numbers, I want to subtract two numbers, how can I do? I will write like this, 50 plus 60. So this gave me the output of addition. Suppose I want to do subtraction. So this gave me 30. So this is simple basic operations in Python. So as you see, as we write the code, we are getting the output. So there is no need of first declaring the type of the values, whether it's an integer value or a float value. We don't need to tell that we are declaring that value. We just can do our operations and it is simply giving me the output. So these are operations in Python. Now what are these 50 and 60 called? These are called the operands. These operands are performing some operation. Now this plus is called an operator. This minus is also an operator. So this whole thing we say is it is an expression. So we will see more expressions in as we move forward. Now Python operators. Now in Python, now what is an operator? What does an operator do? So operator is a symbol which performs some operations for us. It performs some operations for us. What kind of operation it can be? Now if it is an arithmetic operation, what it will do? Operator, it will do addition, subtraction, multiplication, division. Now these are the basic operators. In other languages, if you have studied, you know about these four operators. But in Python, we have some two more new operators, which I will be telling you. So arithmetic operators are plus, minus, multiplication, division. This float division is a new operator in Python. I will be discussing then. Remainder means the modulus operator, and then exponentiation is also new operator. So these are arithmetic operators, and these operators means symbol. So this plus, minus, these are symbols to denote the type of operation we are doing. So here I will go in this shell, and you know I have shown you plus and minus operation. Similarly, we can do multiplication also. Then we can do, now next one is division. So division is also simple, like suppose 50 divided by 3. So it gave me the answer in points. Why? Because 3, because 50 is not completely divisible by 3. Now what the next operator is, it is float division. Now what is float division will do? It will remove the decimal part. Here you can see the decimal value is also showing. But with float division, the decimal value will get removed. See, the answer came 16. So whenever we want that the decimal part should not come, we can use flow division operator. Then if I want to take the remainder, remainder means like modulus, we can use this percentage sign and we can get the remainder. So it will give me the remainder 2. Similarly, now if I want to do, now suppose I want to calculate the power of any number. Suppose I want to calculate pi to the power 2. So in Python, we have an exponentiation operator. So we can do 5 double asterisk 2. So it will give me 25. So these are the arithmetic operators in Python. Now order of operations. Now if suppose in an, we have an expression in Python and where there are multiple type of operators present. Suppose in this example, as you see, 5 plus 9 minus 6 into 10 divided by 20. Here there are many arithmetic operators, plus, minus, multiply and divide. Now what will I do? How will I know which one to evaluate first? So for this, we use order of operations, and which operator will be evaluated first. So here we have some priority to give. Parenthesis will be evaluated first. Then exponents will be evaluated secondly. Then multiplication and division will have the same priority. So multiplication, division, flow division, and then remainder, these will be having the same priority. If they are present in an expression, we will be evaluating it on the same priority. But if suppose we are putting the brackets, then we will be evaluating the bracket part first. So we have to keep in mind about that. Then addition and subtraction will also be evaluated together. So these are the order of operations. Now Python variables and types. Now what is a variable? A variable is a name given to your value. Suppose if I want to store a value in my computer memory, I want to store a value. How will I store it? I will store it by variable. So a variable stores a type of value. A value can be an integer, a string, a float, any type of value. So suppose I want to store number 6 or any integer value, how will I store? I will declare it in a variable. So a equals to 6, where a is called the variable. And I press enter. Now, how will I know whether it has stored or not? So how can I check? I will just put a and press enter. So it gave me 6. This is the way we store a value in our memory. So this a has stored the value 6. So now this is stored in the memory. So when there is will be no use, automatically this will be destroyed. So this variable will be destroyed. So when we save our code, right now in this shell, we cannot save our code. If we want to save our code, we have to click file, new file. Here we can write our Python code. Now Python file is saved with the format .py. So if I want to permanently save my code, I will have to use this file. I have to use a new file. Okay, so this is the variable. Now we have some variable rules to follow. Now when you declare a variable, you should follow some rules. What are the rules? The variable must start with a letter or underscore. Then it must consist of letters and numbers and underscores. So these are the two rules. It should start with a letter or underscore only. It should not start with a number. You have to keep this in mind. Then a variable is case sensitive. Case sensitive means if you are declaring a variable small a and also a variable capital A. So those two are different. If I'm declaring a equals to 6, then I'm declaring capital A equals to 5. And if I get a and I do capital A. So see, the values are different. It didn't mean that small a and capital A are both same. So you have to keep this in mind that variables are case sensitive. Case sensitive means uppercase and lowercase are different, have different meanings. We can store a string variable in capital A, string value in capital A, an integer value in small a. So these both will be different. That doesn't mean that small a and capital A are same. Now, here I have shown some valid variable names. So these are some valid variable names. Name, age. These are valid variable names. Tom 25 underscore max. We can declare like this. Now, what are the invalid variable names? You should not have a variable name starting with a number, as I told you. So this is invalid. We should also not declare our variable like hash name. So this is also wrong. Then there should be no reserved word as a variable name. Reserve, what are reserved words? These are keywords. These are built-in words. Like there are some built-in words in programming languages like if, else, then, while, for. These are the reserved words. We cannot use them as keywords. It will give us error. Now, Python data types. So, till now, what I was covering was the variable. Now, what are these variables storing? These variables are storing some value. Now, these values can be of any type. It can be of integer. It can be of string. It can be a decimal value. So, what are these integer, string, decimal values? These are some data types. Data type means the type of the value stored in a variable. So, if I want, so what are the types of data types in Python? These are numbers. Numbers consist of integers and booleans. Booleans means 0 and 1. Only 0 and 1. 0 means false and 1 means true. Then floating point numbers, these are the decimal values. Complex numbers, these are the numbers which are having the real and imaginary form, as we have studied in maths. Now first we will see integers. Now integers means the simple integer numbers. From like this, 10, 15, 19, 17, these are all integers. Now integer can be negative as well as positive. So if I want to store a negative number, I can just write minus 7 and I will write a here. So it gave me minus 7. So this is integer type, data type. So this integer is a data type here. But in Python, we don't need to tell that I'm declaring an integer type. Suppose in Java or C, we write like this, int a equals to minus 7. But here we don't need to write like this. We can just declare our value like this. Simple. Then booleans. Now booleans represents true and false. So in true and false, these are string. But if I want to get the equivalent of true and false, it will be giving you using this bool function. So suppose if I want to get the equivalent of true, true means 1. So how will I get the equivalent of true? Or how will I get true? So here we have a function called bool. So you can write bool and pass 1. So it will give me true. Similarly, if you type bool 0, it will give me false. Now suppose if you, now this true and false, what does this mean? So in any programming language, if you are passing any number, that means it is true. If you are passing an empty field, suppose you are not passing anything, then this means also false. And if you are passing some number inside this, suppose you are passing 10, then this means true. So an empty bracket means that it is false. And a number inside a bracket, that means it is true. So this is Boolean. Then floating point numbers. Now floating point numbers means a decimal number. A number having fractional part is a floating point number. Example this, 3.14519. This is a floating point number. Now fractional numbers can be written in two forms. So the decimal numbers are in two forms. Fractional form are the simple ones. So suppose I want to get the fractional number, so 3500.56. This is a fractional number. Now, there is another form in floating point, which are the exponent form. As you have studied, what is an exponent? It is any number raised to the power into 10 to the power of something. So suppose I want to write 3500. So in Python, we denote exponent like e02. What does this mean? This means 3500 into 10 to the power 2. Now, if I write anything in exponent form and I press enter, this will give me the fractional form of that number. So it will give me like this. It gave this. So whenever we write a number in, suppose a number is very long, we cannot write so much zeros. So how can I denote a very large number in Python? We can use this form. We can use an exponent form to write that number. So if this shell is giving me the fractional form of that number, this form, it's giving me this form when I write the exponent here. So this means floating point number has two forms. One is the simple decimal form, which is the fractional form, and the second is the exponent form. Then complex numbers. Now, what are complex numbers? Complex number means the form which is having real and imaginary part. Real part is the part which is having an integer value. Like a here is, it can be a real number, like 3 here, 3 and 6. Then imaginary is the root value. Suppose I write root 2. Root 2 means 2j. So how we denote a root number? We denote it using j. So how we declare a complex number? Suppose there we declare a complex number like this. 3 plus 5j. Here 3 is the real part and 5 is the imaginary part. So it is represented, imaginary part is represented using j. So suppose I want to add two complex numbers. So again I am going to declare second complex number like 4 plus 6j. Now suppose I want to add this. How can I add? I can write c equals to a plus b. And I will write c here to see the output. So it gave me 7 plus 11j. So this is the way we get the addition of two complex numbers. Similarly, we can subtract them also. A minus b. So it will give me the subtraction of those two complex numbers. Now suppose I want to extract the real part of this number, of this variable. This variable is having real and imaginary part. Suppose I want to extract the real part. How will I extract? I will write a dot real. So this will give me the real part. So if I want to extract the imaginary part, I will write a dot image. It will give me the imaginary part. So this is the complex number in Python. Then strings. Now string is another data type in Python. What is a string? String is a sequence of characters. And each character can be individually accessed using its index. Now a string, if we declare a string in Python, first of all, how do we declare a string? We take a variable and inside this we write any string. Now this string is stored in the form of index. Indexing means each character is indexed by an index number starting from 0. This H will have 0 index, E will have 1 index, L will have 1, another L will have 1, and this will have another index. So 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. 0 to 4 are the indexes. So why these indexes are there? So that we can extract a particular character from a string. Suppose I want to extract the second character from a string. So how will I extract? I will write str of 1. So str of 1 means E. So it gave me E. So this means, so this index 1 is the index here. And it this index is the location of that character. So this E is stored at location 1. So 1 is called the index. Similarly, H is stored at the location 0. Got it? Then strings are immutable. Means we cannot change the value of string. We cannot change the value. Suppose if I try to change the value of E and I will replace it with F. So it will give error. So E is at location 1, and if I try to change its value to F, it will give me error. See, str object does not support item assignment. We cannot assign any new element inside any string and inside an already created string. We cannot change its value. Then this type function. Now those were all the data types in Python. Now we come to some other function. Type will give me the data type of the variable. Suppose I want to know the data type of the variable A. Here A. This I want to know the type. So what I can do? I can write type and I can write A. So this will give me class complex. That means A is a complex data type, complex number data type. Now type conversion. Now what is type conversion? Type conversion means if I want to convert data type of a variable into some other data type. So suppose if I have a variable called, suppose I declare a variable C and I pass 11 here. Now suppose I want to convert this into decimal number. So for decimal number, what data type we have? We have float. So how can we convert? We can declare a new variable and we can pass, we can declare float and inside this we can pass C. So that means C will be converted into decimal number. Now if I write D, I will get 11.0. So suppose I have a variable called, I have a number 12.30. if I want to convert it into an integer type, so it will remove the 30 from here. How can I convert? I can write integer of e. So it gave me 12. So this is the way we can do type conversion in Python. Next we have print and input function. So what is a print function? Now suppose if I want to get an output, if I want to display something on the screen, in Python we use print. So how will I write? Suppose I want to display my anything. I want to display hello world. I press enter. So this will give me the hello world output. So this is print. Now this print has some features here. So what are those features? We have an argument here called separator. Now suppose I want in between this hello world, I want a dollar sign. So I'll show this thing. Right, print. Before that, I want to tell you one more thing. Now this print, suppose here I'm writing this hello world in single line. So I can separate it using comma. So that then also it will give me the same output. Suppose I write like this, print hello comma world. So again it gave me hello world, same output. So this comma can be used to separate two strings. Now suppose I want to add a dollar sign between hello world, how can I add? I can use separator argument. So suppose I write the same thing, hello comma world. We have an argument sep, this is a separator argument. Here I can mention dollar. So it gave me hello dollar world. So this SEP is for the separator argument. Okay. Now we have one more argument in print, which is the end argument. So for this, I will be showing you in another file. Suppose I write two print statements. And another print statement. And I will save this file first of all. So I can save it by any name. Here I can save it on any directory. So I am saving this by the name demo10.py. Any name can be there. So this py is the extension when we save the file, a Python file. So I will click save. Now my file is saved. Now when I run this code, it will give me the output on this shell. And how will it give me the output? It will give me the output in two lines. In first line, it will give me hello. And in the second line, it will give world. So this is the way it gave me the output. Now suppose I don't want this output in the second line. I want hello and world in the same line. So how can I do it? Using this end. I can pass one argument end here. Suppose I want space after hello. And as after the space, in the same line, I get world. So I can pass space here. And then I will save this file. And I will again run. So this gave hello space world. So this is the feature of a print statement. It has some features like separator and an argument. We can pass these, and these two also have some helpful ways to work with print statement. So after print, we have one more function called input function. Now suppose I want to take input from the user. Till now, what I was doing was I was taking my own type of values, and I was like here I was taking two values here and I was adding this. These two values were my own choice of values. Suppose I want the user to take his own value and get the output. So how will we take in Python? How we take input? So I will show in this same file. So suppose I want to display my name on the screen with some message. So how will I declare? I will take this variable and I will pass one input function. This input function is used to take the input from the user. So I'm asking the user, enter your name. Now when this user will enter their name, I want some message should come after entering. So I'm printing hello, comma, str. And I will save this and I will run this. So it's asking me enter your name. So I'm entering my name, Dharna. Now it gave me hello, Dharna. Why? Because in print statement, I passed this message. Okay, and there I passed the value of that name. This name was stored in str, so I passed it in the inside the print statement. Now what happens in input function in Python is by default this input takes string values only. It will treat any input as string. Suppose I want to add two numbers. So I want to add two numbers. Here I will write A equals to input, enter first number. Then I will write B equals to input, enter second number. Now, as you know how we add C equals to A plus B, and then I will print that result which is coming inside C, and I will save it. I will run this. Now what will happen? First it will tell me to enter the first number, then it will tell me to enter the second number. Now what will happen? It will give me 56. Why? Because in Python the default input is string. So this is treating 5 and 6 as a string, and it is concatenating it. Rather than addition, doing addition, it is concatenated it. As you know, this plus is a concatenation operator in string. If you have studied other languages in Java, so you know this plus is a concatenation operator for string. So, and A and B are treated as strings. Now, how can I treat them as integers? I will write int function here, int. I will pass int here in both. Here also int. And I will save this again and I will run this. Now if I pass the first number as 5 and the second number as 6, it will give me 11. So this means that if this these two numbers are now treated as an integer. So we have to tell this, we are passing a integer value here. Suppose I want to add two floating numbers, two decimal numbers, so I can pass float here. Here also float. And I will save it. And I will run. So I am writing 12.34. Then I am passing second number as 23.45. So it gave me the addition of those two decimal numbers. So this was all about input function. So this is all in the first Python tutorial. So thank you.